Thank you, everyone, for joining me. Welcome to Unboxing Quantum Computing. I have a 12-year-old daughter at home who watches a lot of YouTube, and when I told her that my talk was called Unboxing Quantum Computing, she said, "Don't forget to tell everyone to like and subscribe at the end of your presentation." But this is a GOTO event, so instead I'm going to be asking you to rate it in the GOTO guide. Okay, so my name is Murray Thom. I've presented at a few GOTO events, but not this presentation. A lot of this material will be new. And I'm the Vice President of Product Management at D-Wave System, which means I do a lot of work talking with people outside the organization. We were hearing earlier on from Klaus about facing out and getting people's input about what kind of product do they need. And I actually find these events extremely helpful for me in terms of finding out from folks who are developing software and building software products what they would need from quantum computing in order to be able to see it brought into their businesses or used to benefit their customers. And I've also had the benefit of working at D-Wave for a little over 19 years. I just celebrated my 19th anniversary, actually, at D-Wave. And in that time, I've had the opportunity to build a few quantum computers by hand. I've been out all over the world to talk to people about, what quantum computers are and what kind of problems that they solve. And then I actually sort of changed the phase of my career to sort of have a third phase, which was about making it easier for people to program quantum computers in practical applications with our Ocean open source software, our Leap quantum cloud service, and hybrid solver service. So we're going to be talking about that a little bit today. We've got plenty of time, which is going to be fun. First thing I wanted to do, a little warm-up exercise. I'm going to ask you all to show of hands if you have friends or close family. Not extended networks, but people who are close to you who work in schools. So show your hands if you know someone who works in a school or a hospital or in construction or in manufacturing. Okay, so I'm pretty sure that amongst those four that we covered everybody, right? There was a lot of hands for each of those answers. In fact, I can't go to a party without, or like a family event, without talking to someone about teaching or nursing or things like that. And from those conversations with those family members and close family friends, there's so much about that work that's really meaningful for them, right? The meaningful aspects of their work are helping students to learn, seeing that connection in their eyes as they're starting to learn new concepts, or improving somebody's wellness, helping them to get healthier in an important and critical time in their lives. Building homes or buildings that we all use, like this one, where we can all sit extremely comfortably during some keynote presentations, or also manufacturing products that get used around the world. There's a lot of pride in people's eyes when they're building things that people need and they use regularly. But we also know from talking to people in those careers that not every aspect of that work is enjoyable. And some of the stories that are on the other side are, geez, we had to spend, dozens or hundreds of hours working out a schedule for our school. Or, geez, I got shift work at the hospital, and it's like I got terrible shifts. Maybe it was in the construction industry. There was a huge pause in our project because one of the trades wasn't able to come in because they were booked on some other job. Or in manufacturing, my machine was left idle because the materials didn't arrive on time. And those lessons, I mean, many of them are particularly poignant now at this time in our lives when we have supply chain disruptions, huge, capacity surges in hospitals, and also people trying to figure out how to conduct schools during a changing global environment. So the whole talk today is about, how to provide a tool and then also make the tool consumable so that we can build solutions that are actually taking away some of the aspects of people's works that's not really driving their, why they go to work every day, and so that more of their work is about the meaningful side of their work and what they can accomplish when they're there. Okay, so I've been to talk to a lot of developers at GOTO conferences, and I got a great piece of advice, which was, if I knew more what quantum computers could be used for, I'd be more interested in learning about what they are and how they work. So that's what we're doing here. We're going to start about what are demonstrations of business value and how can you actually use this productively in applications to get results? So here are four examples, and we're going to be diving into a couple of them in more detail, but BBVA is working with a startup company, Multiverse Computing, on using quantum computers for portfolio optimization in the context of risk in order to find the best investments that you can make while sort of for the given amount of risk that you're willing to take. And they're also looking at things like trading trajectories. So big financial organizations are having to make large movements in their positions. And as they're making those moves, they can only do it in big blocks. People start to realize the movement that they're taking, and they start pre-trading and eating away at the value of those big moves in their position. So they're looking at ways to optimize those trading trajectories over time using this kind of technology. Save-On Foods is a mid-sized Canadian grocer. They operate their grocery business over 3 million square kilometers. They have a lot of interesting and complex grocery challenges. Volkswagen is actually a really early pioneer in quantum computing and looking at it for traffic flow optimization in their manufacturing floor. I'll go into that in a little bit more detail. And Minton and AI is a startup company that operates all throughout the world. They are looking at not just protein folding, but protein design. So when they were looking at developing protein therapeutics for COVID-19, it was about choosing amino acids in a sequence which would fold in a particular way so that they could bind and to the COVID virus in particular designed ways. And each time they have that choice, there's 20 possible combinations of amino acids they could choose at each site, and then that compounds as they go, and that all has an effect on how the protein is going to fold. So that design challenge is combinatorially complex. That's a feature you're going to see as we're talking through examples today, problems which have big combinatorics. And they have actually worked out how to use our hybrid solver technologies so they can use quantum computers to design proteins that have actually been synthesized and now taken to live virus testing. So there are quantum design proteins that are out in the world. Okay, so I'm going to dive into these in a little bit more detail, a couple of them in particular. Volkswagen started their work with, I think, a really valuable mindset, which was, I want to work on something extremely practical, something that everyone would understand. You know, it's not about, geez, I want to use quantum computers to do machine learning to build space elevators to the moon. They just wanted to do traffic flow optimization and show that you could use this in practical applications. So they actually launched what they sort of positioned as the first real-time commercial use of a quantum computing at the Web Summit in Lisbon. They actually were optimizing the routes of the conference buses who were shuttling the conference attendees around using Android devices for the drivers with real live traffic information and making remote calls to our quantum computer live as the buses were driving around. And as complicated as it is to build quantum computing systems, supporting live real-time applications brings a whole bunch of other technical and infrastructure challenges, which were really fun to face because for me, you know, it's not about the technology, it's about, you know, solving problems and helping people to solve problems. So that was exciting. But that lesson that they learned from using that quantum computer to optimize traffic flow caused them to understand, okay, well, now we're understanding problem formulation. How do we pose problems for the quantum computer that are sort of suitable for quantum computing and take advantage of its capabilities versus what classical computers are good at? And they started looking internally to their own applications, and one of which was they have a long manufacturing floor, which has a lot of elements to it, and it's very difficult to optimize. And so they minimize the number of aspects of the manufacturing floor that can impact the overall schedule because they have to plan it and take so much time to do that. So some of the elements, like choosing paint colors, are not allowed to impact what determines basically the actual sequence of cars that are moving down the floor, which means they can only do optimization at the last minute. They can only sort of say, okay, now we have to change the orders of the cars if we want to minimize the number of paint switches. And by changing the orders of the car, I mean virtual swaps. So they find two cars that are identical on the line, and they basically swap their order if they needed different paints so that they can maximize the sequence of colors of cars in that are going to receive like a dark base coat versus the set they're going to get a light base coat. And they managed to do this calling the quantum computer, and they saw an 80% reduction in waste. So there was five times fewer color switches, which means that that introduces less cost and also means less waste basically coming from the production line. Okay, the example here with Save-On Foods, this is a really meaningful example to me because I started talking with the folks at Save-On Foods just as the pandemic was starting. And this was a time where they were seeing a lot of volatility in the business, and they recognized that, you know, grocery store, like running grocery stores, is really important and crucial for all of us. And I'm sure many of us who were thinking about, you know, am I going to be able to buy the groceries that I need every day? You know, that was really important, and it's something that they really took to heart. So they were really looking at their own internal operations and saying, you know, there's a lot of grocery optimization things that we're doing that take a lot of time. And so we work closely with them, and we help them to develop a problem formulation for some of these important problems. And that managed to reduce the complexity of the problem from 25 operational hours down to 2 minutes. And these were not like the super fun operational hours. These were the ground and pound, working your way through grocery optimization hours. So the folks who were actually working on this problem were delighted to actually see this solution. This allowed them to focus on other aspects of their business that they felt were going to be really important for them. And the other thing is that when you have to spend 25 hours doing a task, you've got to do it way ahead of time. But if you can do it in 2 minutes, you can start to do it with like much more relevant real-time information. So it was a really big impact for the business. And like the Volkswagen example, they've actually now gone into other areas looking at their business to determine other places where they can use the quantum computers and application. Denso is a large auto parts manufacturer in Japan. They've also looked at traffic flow optimization. But in particular, they were interested in optimizations on their manufacturing floor. So they have a whole series of autonomously guided vehicles that are moving things around their manufacturing floor. And they're not allowed to collide. So if their paths cross, one of them has to wait while the other one is passing through that particular area. And it's really important that they don't collide, because that's a lot more costly than just trying to save a little time. And so they were actually able to map that problem, again, you know, finding the right problem formulation for it, for our quantum technology. And in so doing, even maximizing for safety, they managed to reduce the wait times by 15%. Okay, so those are, I'm leading right into the application examples, just to kind of really bring us into, okay, there's several different spaces where we can use this. But there's also like, you know, quantum computing, it's new, it's not like the types of technologies that we're really familiar with. Why are people making the change? It's sort of disruptive. And the reason is because of the enormous potential. So a lot of the theory in the early days for quantum computers showed that they have the possibility to really speed up calculations. And what's interesting is, so particularly, there's lots of different models of quantum computing, and there's also lots of different ways to implement quantum computers. At D-Wave, we're doing this with solid-state chips. So we're actually fabricating them the way that our semiconductor chips are made. And that has actually allowed us to double the size of our processors and increase their level of integration regularly, year on year, sort of like every 18 months to 2 years. So we're seeing an exponential growth in the size of the processors, just like you get with Intel processors. The difference is that the problem complexity is growing exponentially with its scale. So there's this possible opportunity for a super exponential growth in computational power. And any place where you get a super exponential growth, you suddenly get this massive disruption where you used to do everything in a particular way, you know, and then a short period of time later, it's radically like the wrong solution for what you're doing. We had the story about Blockbuster a little bit earlier. What I find is really fun here is that these are a couple of images from work that we've done in quantum material simulation. So simulating lattices to find what their properties, their magnetic properties are going to be. And that might seem a little bit esoteric, but magnetic properties, I mean, are actually an important part of electric engines and important parts of devices that we use commercially. And also, for those of you who have a machine learning background, there's sort of a machine learning domain, which is about drawing probabilistic samples. These lattices can produce really interesting probability distributions that you can sample from, which has interesting implications in machine learning research. But the reason that I'm mentioning this is because in the space of two product generations, we went from not being able to calculate these material properties to being 3 million times faster than the best classical software that was being used to do it. And in fact, we did this work in collaboration with Google, and they had actually hired one of the world experts on their quantum program who had done simulations of this kind, and we worked with them in terms of optimizing the classical side to compete with. So this really was a pretty heavy sort of benchmarking lift. And then you take that and then you contrast with some of the things we're talking about in terms of real-world examples, like the 500 times speed up and save on foods. So it's absolutely possible to make a difference in a commercial application in a way that your customer or your end user is really going to find useful. And it also has the potential, I'm going to show you as we get to the end of the talk, to progress even further and faster. Now, this is a slide showcasing some data from the Boston Consulting Group about the total addressable market for quantum computing in the near term and then in the longer term. starting in the billions of dollars for those of us who are, you know, interested in bigger picture than just billions of dollars, to the hundreds of billions of dollars in the long run. But the reason I'm showing this to you is not for the common reason that people would look at the total addressable market. It's because the portion of this market that the Boston Consulting Group believes is available to quantum computing providers is 20%. And the reason why that's significant is because the rest of the 80% is available to you. It's through using the technology and bringing it into your application spaces. That's where the real value is. And no technology is about the technology itself, right? All successful technologies build an economy and build opportunity for other people that they can put into use and see value in. And that's what I'm really hoping is going to happen as we continue developing these technologies. Now at D-Wave, I have received criticism before about giving a bit of a sales pitch, so I'm going to try desperately to avoid that kind of criticism, but I'll understand if you feel that's the direction I'm going here. Part of the reason why I mention this is because this isn't just using CPUs and GPUs that we're all familiar with. The context of what is available with this technology and how it's available is different. So I'm going to share some information with you, but take it as you will. We've got the largest 5,000 qubit processor that's available called the Advantage System. We just had our user group meeting in September and we released a performance update for it. That's the largest human-made programmable quantum computer in the world. And we have also provided and set up, which I'm quite proud of, the Leap Quantum Cloud Service so that it's available to all of you right now. In fact, during this talk, we're going to log on and we're going to run some problems on quantum computers that are in Vancouver while we're talking. And in that cloud service, you know, the important thing is, interesting, when you think about quantum mechanics and we talk about how weird it is, part of the reason why quantum mechanics is weird is because we never interact with it in our daily lives. There's no kids' toys that behave quantum mechanically. So getting immediate access from a programming standpoint is going to be important in terms of us getting a chance to see what quantum computers can do for us. And we're really trying to make the bars lower and easier, so we've created a set of searchable open source examples with our Ocean toolkit that you can run right in the integrated into development environment in Leap. So you don't have to worry. I mean, many of you will find it really easy to set up your own environment and install our local tools and pip install them, but you don't have to start there. You can just work right in the environment and start learning there as you get going. And we also have introduced, since last I spoke to anybody in a conference in person, our hybrid solver service. So for any of you who might have seen me speak at the end of 2019, at that time we had open sourced a framework for incorporating quantum computing with classical computing in a set of workflows, using the quantum computer for potentially pre-processing or post-processing. But the feedback that we got from users at that time was, hey, this is great, and it's awesome to know that this is possible, but designing algorithms and parameter tuning them is not really what I want to be spending my time doing, right? I want to be focused on the problems I'm trying to solve. And I'd really like you to take care of this. So we still have that open source framework, but we've introduced hybrid solvers that are professionally designed and parameter tuned to allow you to submit large enterprise level application problems and get answers back quickly. And we'll run on a newly announced one, the constrained quadratic model solver, which we also just talked about at our user group meeting. So with that, we'll jump to the demo. Now, I did do a quick test. I'm on the cinema Wi-Fi, and we're going to be submitting to the systems in Vancouver. So bear with me if anything doesn't go quite as smooth as I'm hoping it's going to. If you want to get access to Leap, you can just search for D-Wave Leap. Any of the top links will basically take you there. Go. Why is that not going? Oh, I see. It's just slow. Oh, I see. There we go. We're disconnected. We'll reconnect. Disconnect. Reconnect. Let's see. Well, you know, these things happen when you're doing live demos. Let's try disconnecting again. Connect automatically. Internet open. Refreshing the browser. Oops. There we go. Good tips from the audience, pro skills here. This is good. Okay, so we're back online. We should be back online. ESPN. There we go. Terrific. Save the day. Okay, so any of these top links will take you to the Quantum Cloud Service. And this one will give you a description of it as well, including some videos that you can watch and click to take you there. But I've already signed up and logged into the system using my personal account. So this is what you'll see when you actually land inside Leap. So it starts with some information to get you started, interacting with our demos and access to our resources and our examples. Right off the top of the page, it'll show you that you're going to get like a free amount of time on the quantum computer or on the hybrid solvers. And if you are willing to, if you want to purchase time because you want to use it for commercial applications, you can absolutely do that. But we're also really interested in developing a community who are interested in programming it and posing problems and working on things together. So if you actually link a repository and you're willing to open source your code that with the time that you develop for free, then we'll renew that access every month and you can continue to get free time on these resources as time goes on. So there we are. This is my account. I've run a series of examples, a couple of tests earlier on today to make sure that the network was working. And our endpoints in Europe and North America. Right now, we don't have solvers up in Europe, but I had talked about this previously. We've installed a system at ULIC, the ULIC Supercomputing Center, this would be the area where you'd find that when you're, then we'll be running demos and locations in Europe with much lower latency. Now, I've loaded a demo here called Resource Distribution. So we're going to jump right into the deep end here with an application that's meant to run at a variety of scales, where we're not going to have to worry too much about the low-level sort of machine code of the quantum computer. We're fairly far up the technology stack. And the reason I'm saying that is because we developed that technology stack just to make it much faster and easier to formulate problems. And I think, so we're going to go through where the problem formulation is here, but first I'm going to start you by like the description of the problem. And the situation here is a set where you have a series of hospitals which are spread over a city location, and some of them may have shortages of beds, and some of them may have surpluses of beds. And so what you'd like to do is put them together into groups where amongst a small group, a relatively small partition, there's a surplus of beds. And then you want to do that in a way where you're minimizing the transfer costs of having to move resources between them, whether it's patients to beds or other resources. So that's basically the challenge, and the idea is to develop a demo which builds against that. So what's nice about this is that there's a lot in the code. This is readable? Okay, good. I can zoom it in a little bit if we want to see it a touch closer. There's a lot in the code which is about installing packages and setting up variables. But really, the actual key part when you're looking at using quantum computers in application is about problem formulation. What are the elements where you're actually going to formulate the problem that's going to get passed to the quantum computer or the quantum hybrid solver? And these are those elements. So the first one is a constraint. Each hospital must be assigned to exactly one group. So in this case, there's a nice helpful mathematical formulation here. Sum over all binary variables which assign a hospital to a group must be one and only one. So it says sort of here at the beginning, we're going to set for each pair of hospital, index I, and group, there's going to be a binary variable which indicates that that hospital has been assigned to that group. So what we're going to do is say, okay, well, then for every hospital, we want to have a one-hot constraint. And this is called add discrete because it basically makes like a discrete variable where only one of the options the discrete variable has is allowed to be on for all the binary variables in the range of groups. The second constraint is now we need to make sure that we have a positive number of beds. So in this case, it's just for every hospital that's going to be in that group, you're going to have a binary variable saying, you know, zero is going to be multiplying zero when it's not in the group, and one is going to be multiplying by the number of beds, and you need to add those all up and make sure that it's greater than zero. So again, just for, you know, G and the number of groups that you have, you want to add a constraint so that the sum of the binary variable zero or one, if the hospital's in the group, times the number of beds that it has, which might be positive or negative if it's a surplus or a shortage, is greater than or equal to zero. And so this hybrid solver that we built is specifically designed to allow you to just construct constraints in like a very natural language using this, you know, symbolic greater than or equal to some number to make it like much faster and easier to sort of write these out. Whereas, let's say in previous demonstrations, I would have gone into like truth tables to show you exactly how these are constructed. And you're doing this by thinking through the problem and then adding a component saying, okay, well, I have this constraint, I'm going to add that in. I'm going to have this constraint, I'm going to add that in. And CQM here is the object which represents the model of your problem. The last thing is an objective. And for this objective, we're basically going to sum over all the distances that where transfers are going to have to take place within your group. So this is a few more lines. In this case, we're going to take we're going to set an objective which is equal to 0. So if you're trying to minimize an objective, you're trying to get the number as low as you can, as negative as it can be. So if you start with 0, that's a constant. There's no opportunity to optimize. And then we're going to pick a hospital and a bed out of the set, and then a second hospital and a bed out of the set, and then basically just restrict ourselves to the set where the first one has a surplus and the second one has a shortage, as we're iterating over all the possible ones there. And then say, okay, for these two, we want to add to the objective the distance for the transfer between the hospital with a surplus and a shortage. You don't need to keep track of all the distances, only transfers that would take place between hospitals that have positive and then negative distances. So you add all those distances, and if you exclude the hospitals from the group, then those distances don't get factored in. Those binary variables will be 0, and they'll zero out those terms. And after those distances are added in, then that sets your objective. You set your objective for your CQM, and now you've just constructed a model. This might feel a little unsatisfying for those of you who are algorithm designers, but that is an important part of knowing programming quantum computers, is that you're not telling it how to step through the problem. You're not having to tell it how to use superposition and tunneling to solve the problem. You're actually just describing the problem. It's a little bit like cutting the Sudoku out of the newspaper and then passing it to the machine and coming back with the numbers filled in. So that's it. The rest of the program is the rest of the handling. This is the section that deals with formulating that problem. And if I jump down here, I can show you what it's like to run it. So in this demo here, we took hospitals from New York. And this is sort of a real map that draws from like real hospital locations. The shortages and surpluses, those are artificial. We've added those in. So this is the VA Medical Center, for instance. But I'm going to, just to make sure that this runs quickly, I'm going to keep this to a small number. And then that formulation that I just described to you, that's all that's basically in the code for running it. And then I'm going to give it a minimum 10-second time limit. So that's going to give me about 12 seconds to describe it to you. So this is now actually submitting to the system in Burnaby. The system in Burnaby is actually spinning up workers in the cloud that are going to be running on this problem, taking pieces out of the problem it's working on, passing it to the quantum computer, and then reincorporating its answers back in. So there we are. That's the set of groupings that we got from that small data set of 12 hospitals. So this is the degree of simplicity that we've managed to achieve in quantum computing so far, in terms of trying to build connections and useful technology stacks with open source SDKs to allow you to see how to formulate problems quickly. And we're developing all the time with your input in terms of what you're finding easy or difficult in terms of doing that. But sometimes, you know, as we're doing this and building the technology stack, we don't want to do it in a way which sort of hides the quantum computer. That's a big part of the reason why we're doing this in open source, is that you can see and sort of dive in as you're learning the use cases. You can learn more about the parameter tuning that's happening underneath. And also because it allows us to engage with a variety of people with mathematical backgrounds or development backgrounds or physics-based backgrounds, and they can dive into the technology stack at the level that they're interested in. But it's also because, you know, we're all really curious and interested in quantum computers, and we've really tried to kind of make the quantum computing aspect still really present. So here in Leap, under the resources section, we've got a set of open source code examples, and we're working really hard to sort of build more examples to allow you to draw pieces out that you might need for your applications. I'm going to pull up the clustering example here, and kind of like I mentioned before, I can just click load in the IDE, and this will actually start provisioning cloud resources for you to run on free of charge. Which are basically loading the ocean tools and setting it up for you so that you can start running this example and tweaking it and learning from the way that you're used to learning. It just takes a few seconds. And the reason why I like this example and I'm going to it is because of the title of this talk here, Unboxing Quantum Computing. I can't bring a quantum computer here with me, but this demo example allows us to kind of like dive into a little bit more of the detail. From a programming aspect, because a lot of the developers that I speak to are, you know, really learn things by interacting with code. Code is sort of, I was thinking about Alan's keynote presentation today, where he was showing like a developer window and he was like, WTF, you know, like, why don't we have better CAD tools? But the folks that I know who program professionally, they feel very, very comfortable in that environment. You know, it's kind of like the Matrix, you know, when he was like, oh, I don't even see the Matrix anymore. It's just blonde, brunette. That's what it's like reading code for folks who do it professionally. So examples clustering. Okay, so when I submit this, this is going to run direct to the quantum computer. So this doesn't have the, this is more the machine language that the quantum computer understands, and it doesn't accept constraints. So this has to be reformulated in an unconstrained way. It's basically going to set binary variables to assign a data point to a particular cluster, red, green, or blue. So for each data point, there's going to be three binary variables. And it's going to set a relationship between that color assignment to the color assignment for another data point. And whether they try to line themselves up or whether they try to choose different colors depends on how close or far they are. And that weighting is what's chosen with a nonlinear bias. So this is actually going to go direct to the quantum computer. Wi-Fi permitting here, but we're looking okay for Wi-Fi so far. And then it's going to pull, it's actually running this in a way where it's actually keeping track of all the information that gets sent in the problem and the answer and solution data that comes back, and loading a visual problem inspector. And this is why I really wanted to showcase this for you. So I'm going to just, I'm not going to do a tour because I want to do this reasonably quickly. But this problem inspector here gives us an opportunity to get sort of inside the quantum computer and look at this in a little bit more detail. And this demo is correctly set up with no warnings. But this is the logical problem we are working on. Every one of these binary variables is trying to assign one of the data points to one of the groups. And as a result, they're interconnected to a variety of the other binary variables, sort of deciding whether they want to align with the coloring of another data point or misalign with it because it's further away. And we got a whole sequence of answers back. And the time that it took us to run that, we've got probably a couple of hundred different possible solutions for this clustering one. So this is showing the solution which got where we got five occurrences. But if I hover over this histogram here, you can actually see some of the variables change. So we can actually get a variety of solutions with different energies back as we're looking through that. So that's the great thing about hovering over this. And this is a histogram here. So again, we're trying to optimize by getting low in energy. So that's further to the left. And then the number of occurrences is basically counting up on the right. So what's neat about this is for anybody who's got a physics background, is this is kind of behaving like a real physical system where it's generally trying to get to low energy, but it also has a little bit of temperature. And so that's actually causing it to draw samples from other points. And if you are, you know, let's say what you're trying to do with a quantum computer is factor numbers, then the only answer you care about is like the one answer. But if you're working in optimization, many of these approximate solutions can actually be very useful to you. And looking at the diversity of answers that you get can also be really useful in terms of thinking about, okay, what kind of patterns are there? Maybe the data points are very clear to segment. Maybe they're not. Maybe I'm choosing the wrong number of colors. Okay, and then the other great thing is we can switch views to number two here. In the second view, what we're seeing is this is the actual set of qubits on the processor. So this is the working graph of a 5,000 qubit processor here. And this section down here is where the processor, the problem has been embedded. And this is actually going to show you the relationship between the qubits that are being used and the variables that they're being used to represent. So if I click on a qubit here on the right, that one, it's going to take me into that variable. But the interesting thing is when I click on the variable, what it tells me is that it's not just using that qubit, it's using three qubits. So it's using three qubits to represent that variable, and it's doing that so that it can create a rich set of interconnections to the other variables in the problem. So if you're, you know, as you are working through use cases, as you're interested in learning more about how the quantum computers work and diving into those details, you can do that with these tools and pull them up in a visual way and actually work at some really interesting math in terms of this underconnections. But again, I'm sort of nerding out a bit here. So There we are. That's the demo, the live demo. We don't want to go to ESPN. We're back to the slides. So I just skipped. I had some, just in case the network didn't work, I had some slides in there to cover that, but I was glad we were able to do the demo. Now I'm going to talk about application workflows. And the reason I'm talking about this is because I had a conversation with Carrie Patterson from the Carrera Group, who works in medicine. And she was saying, you know, as she's trying to help bring in new technologies and new solutions to allow them to sort of like find new ways to solve problems and create better solutions, she needs help in terms of understanding where does the quantum computer fit into the broader application workflow. So I've actually talked to a number of people who have been trying to incorporate quantum computing into applications, and there's a few challenges beyond the programming, the problem formulation that sort of come in, and they also influence the choices you're going to make in the problem formulation. So I wanted to talk to you about two or three of those. So the example that she's using here is a clinical decision support system. So this is a scenario where you have a set of medical guidelines which have been translated into a set of compute rules for making decisions about therapies or therapy plans for patients. But that needs to be brought in with actual contextual information about that specific patient, so their electronic health record, which basically has to be brought into informatics. And then those two things have to be pulled together with the clinical context to be able to run that optimization. So this would be sort of the place where the quantum computer would be involved in the application, but there's a lot more to the application necessarily than just that optimization that to produce that therapy plan for that patient. And she's really passionate in looking at situations where there's a lot of these sort of rules and guidelines which are sort of designed in a majority rule kind of a way, right? There's sort of like a medicine isn't medicine if it doesn't work for everybody. If it only worked for some people, it's just tea, sort of a perspective. So moving away from that, you know, with the attitude that, you know, it has to work for everybody for it to be medicine, you have a situation where if you've got a lot more patients with type 2 diabetes than type 1 diabetes, then you start setting up rules with a little bit of a confirmation bias that works for people with type 2 diabetes, and you end up ending up with some unintended and negative consequences for those in your community who have type 1 diabetes. There's two other examples here I want to talk about because these are really easy to understand in a very intuitive way. One is sort of operation scheduling for like a manufacturing floor. So in this case, if you're developing the application solution, you're not going to be the one doing the actual scheduling. So it's not really a situation where someone's going to sit down with you and tell you all the rules that you need to put into the system, and then you're going to write some code and it just runs like that forever. It's going to evolve, and it has to be run by someone who produces the schedules for the manufacturing floor. But there's also an interesting and key part here, which is that the expertise on what happens when you're operating the machines, maybe when you're bringing in copper versus when you're bringing in steel, is that there's a change in how that system actually needs to operate. And so you need to be able to write your application in a way where that distributed expertise ends up getting factored in. That's important from the perspective that now you're no longer writing problem formulations for quantum computers. You're writing user interfaces, and those write the problem formulations for the quantum computers. And the other key thing with those is that a lot of folks think like, oh, I'll just write this like, I'll optimize their entire global operations and then we'll just drop it into their system. And nobody takes on brand new disruptive technologies that way. The solution structure really needs to like match their business process. This is going to be really helpful because these kinds of problems, they're not like the problems that classical computers face when they're breaking problems down, right? If you're breaking iPhones or driverless cars into flops, like addition and multiplication, every addition is just as complex as the last one. Every multiplication, as long as the variable size is the same, you know how complex that is. These problems get like huge ranges in overall complexity. If you have integrated business systems, if you've got all that data available to you, that's awesome. Make use of those. But you don't need big data to get started, because even at, you know, dozens of machines with dozens of operators, these can get enormously complex for computers to work out solutions to. And so following the way the business process is sort of broken that down is actually a great way to start. You introduce solutions that people can then review manually. Maybe they can tweak them and modify them. And as they get confidence that the software is actually producing a solution that, you know, they recognize as operable, then they'll be more willing to take it on in a more broad way through the business process or combining pieces together. Class scheduling is an important one. I have a family member that I talked to who's in education. And so I connected with some principals in a middle school in British Columbia, which is the province of Canada where I live. And I was talking to them about the challenge of scheduling schools. All of their scheduling kind of went out the window when COVID happened. But they have a similar situation. So they've got centralized scheduling. It's the vice principals and the principals who do the classroom scheduling. And they literally spend hundreds of hours scheduling classrooms and classes and rooms for students based on preferences. And again, you have a situation where it's the individuals involved, the teachers and the students, who have the preferences. But in that situation, it's not about rules about machines operating. It's people's preferences, and those preferences change when they need to take a medical leave or when their kids' after-school programs change. So there's a wide variation of those preferences, and those preferences need to change. And part of the reason why they're not using the software that they have made available to them to optimize the classroom schedule is because it's not living, breathing software. They haven't created the user interfaces that do the problem formulation. So they wrote it, and then the conditions changed, and then they can only use a fraction of the software for the task, and it still takes them a lot of time. And that aspect of setting up calendars for people to sort of indicate, I want my breaks to come one after the other, or I want my breaks to come at the same time of day on two different days, is part of, I think, the task that we all face as a community in terms of software development to make these kinds of solutions easier. And in so doing, lift away a lot of the drudgery of the work that's preventing them from doing really meaningful things. It was quite difficult to get time with a couple of principals, even an hour. And they were late coming to the meeting where I was going to ask them to describe the problem that they were solving. And the reason they were late is because a student was having a seizure, and they needed to go and make sure that that student was getting medical care. So, that's how great it is to have people who really care about what they're doing, and they have to spend 120 hours on school scheduling every year, and it's a very painful process. So there's a lot of value out of creating solutions for people in that space. So the reason I'm going through these in a little bit more detail is that's part of the reason why we're really trying to get a set of open source examples to get people started, is because as trivial as solving Sudoku puzzles or the N Queens example might be, as you're working over calendars, you need to be able to work over grids and find ways to construct constraints and relationships between your variables. And these examples are meant to help you with that process and sort of see those connections between working with calendars and working with puzzles. We've also got things for assigning things to groups. I talked about clustering. There's graph coloring and cell tower frequencies. Looking at aspects of network coverage, min vertex cover, and satellite placement. If you're designing networks and you want them to be minimally redundant, you want to make sure that you have enough to cover the network in case there's a failure. So there's lots of repeated calculations, and those calculations are very complex to do. And also looking at interacting elements, maximum independent set, which also has a lot of foundational relationships to portfolio optimization, where you're looking to invest in assets which are relatively uncorrelated with one another. Okay, I promised Preben I'd be ending early, but I didn't want to shortchange this last aspect. So mostly I've been talking about applications and use case, but there's some really exciting results I wanted to talk to you about on the frontiers of science here, where these commercial systems are doing some really new and fancy things. So Thom Kibble was a researcher who was interested in the theory of the Big Bang, right? This situation where we have this extremely hot explosion where everything is crushed together at very high energy, and at some time later we've got stars and galaxies and planets around. And he wanted to describe how those structures formulate in that process. And so he did that. He proposed it in 1976 and wrote another follow-on paper in 1980. And then a colleague of his, Wojciech Żurek, connected that to quantum systems like superfluids. So in fact, there's a similar process at play in a quantum computer where at one point you have your memory registers are in superpositions of state. So every possible solution is being represented there. So that's a massive exploration phase, right? But there's no information there about where the solution lies. It's just exploring everywhere. And then through in the way our systems operate, there's an annealing process. And then the bits start to take quantum bits start to take classical values like zeros and ones. And that process is a structure that's emerging from what is otherwise sort of like a very disordered state. but it only works when you're able to really isolate that quantum system from the outside. So I showed you earlier when you're running the quantum processor that you get a variety of solutions, and I mentioned this because it's connected to temperature, but we've recently been able to change the way we're operating our quantum processors and take them from operating in a millionth of a second down to 5 billionths of a second. And we've studied that operation from, you know, that's a nanosecond, so from 5 nanoseconds to 70 nanoseconds to look at how structures form. How does an answer begin to emerge from that, like, superposition state of, you know, greater than the number of estimated particles in the universe, number of possible solutions you could be looking at. And what we found was this data here. So this is 5 nanoseconds, and this is getting up to close to 50 or 60 nanoseconds here. And kink density here, think about it as like twists. So kinks are defects in how the structures, and the space between kinks represents those structures that are emerging in your solution. And what they found was that even as we changed different temperatures, operating in this regime, it didn't affect how quickly we managed to get away from frustrated solutions to get to better quality solutions. And then we basically took the theory for describing how the early universe discovered, structure emerged, and that's that gray line underneath. And it's not fit, it just matches it. There's no fitting parameters here. This is just the data overlaid over the theory. And so I just think it's absolutely fascinating that there are common descriptive foundations of how structures emerge in the early universe that is all around us, and how we're able to produce solutions in quantum computers. This was demonstrated with one of the commercial quantum computers that's online right now. It's at the edge of what humans can do with programmable and interactive quantum systems. And it's the state of the art in terms of turning quantum mechanics into useful work. And so, it's this work that is leading into the work we're doing as we're expanding our products to include gate model quantum computers that also require these coherent states to operate over, and that's going to give us other interesting disruptions and accelerations in terms of computation in the future. So I hope I've at least excited your curiosity, and that you'll log on and try things out and have some fun yourself.